Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Mouth to Mouth by Michael Kimball, narrated by George Guidall. This work is copyrighted 2000 by Michael Kimball. This recording is copyrighted 2000 by Recorded Books. On a beautiful summer day, Ellen Chambers watches helplessly as her beloved teenage daughter marries the worst possible man. Ellen knows her new son-in-law has violent tendencies and violent friends. She is certain he will make her daughter's life a hell. And now, Mouth to Mouth.
Chapter 1. On the crest of the hayfield, outside her sheep pasture, Ellen Chambers stood calmly under a green canopy tent while her son-in-law smothered her daughter with wedding cake. Randy was apparently teaching Maureen the first lesson of their married life, getting even with her for smearing his goatee with frosting while she'd fed him his slice. The wedding guests laughed. Even Maureen's high school friends thought it was funny as Maureen tried to duck away from Randy, her swollen belly straining against the silk of her wedding dress. But when Randy wiped his hands on Maureen's dress, then stalked away from her, Ellen finally lost her composure and went to head him off at the beer keg. "Is it my imagination, or is the groom not the son-in-law of your dreams?" Ellen heard the voice behind her. In her heels and close-fitting skirt, her friend Maddie was doing her best to keep pace with her. "He's 27 years old," Ellen said. "She's a junior in high school." "Shy girls always marry outlaws," Maddie said. "You did." She gently took hold of Ellen's arm, stopping her. "Anyway, you don't want to make a scene today." Ellen shut her eyes, took a heavy breath. Madeline Sterling had been her closest friend since high school and usually gave good advice. It helped that she was a psychotherapist. "So," Maddie said, changing the subject as she turned them around, "do I see more sheep in your pasture?" Ellen laughed, finally grateful for Maddie's intervention. "We need the wool," Ellen told her. "The phone company's threatening to shut us off. The barn's falling down." Maddie gave her friend a sympathetic look. "Elle, if it's just money, you know I'd love to help." Ellen shook her head. "Thanks, but we'll be fine. The wedding set us back a bit, that's all." "Hmm," Maddie said. "I also can't help but notice that the minute Maureen moves out, you expand your flock." "Oh, Maddie, no analysis today." Ellen turned away and found herself making eye contact with a young man standing in the shade of the oak tree beside her house. She averted her eyes, as she had done twice already. Large and strikingly handsome, with dark eyes and long black sideburns, he nursed a styrofoam cup of coffee. The cuffs of his white shirt were rolled up. "No one seems to know anything about him," said Maddie, observing the direction of Ellen's glance. "I'm sure you've asked around." "Discreetly." Ellen mustered a smile. "His hair," Maddie went on in a low voice, covering her mouth. "Would you call that wavy or curly?" Maddie ran her hand through her own jet black cut, which matched her black silk designer suit. Though Ellen loved Maddie, the friends couldn't have been more different. Twice divorced, Maddie was always on the lookout for her next conquest. Ellen had been married since her teens and looked homespun, even when dressed up. Her hair was long and mahogany-colored. It fell down the middle of her back in a thick braid. She was tall, but with a curve to her hip and breast. At 36, Ellen felt strong and healthy and young, much too young to be a grandmother. "How old do you think?" Maddie asked, eyeing the dark young man. 33? Not a day younger than 30. "Dream on. 20, insisted Ellen, just as the young man glanced over at her again. Uncomfortable, she turned to look for Scott, her husband, spotted him leaning against the paddock fence with their new son-in-law. The two men were smoking cigars and talking intently. Scott, with his easy manner and ready smile, worked hard to make sure nobody in Destin disliked him. It bothered Ellen to see him trying so hard with Randy. She heard a sudden burst of singing and turned to see Maureen standing at the beer keg with her friends, posing for snapshots with her arms around them, swaying and singing along with the three-piece band. Unavoidable, Ellen supposed, the way Maureen mirrored her own young life. The rebellion, the recklessness, the careless pregnancy, the misfit husband. But somehow across all these years, the reflection seemed so warped, almost as though Maureen was knowingly orchestrating her own destruction. "I feel like she's drowning herself and there's nothing I can do to save her," Ellen whispered to her friend. "Don't you think that's a wee bit overstated?" "Maddie, I don't even know her anymore," Ellen said, sorrow almost closing her throat. "It's like I just opened my eyes and here we are." Maddie gave her a look. "You're both growing up," she said. "That's called life." "Call it what you want," Ellen said. "It's not the life I wanted, for her or me." "Ladies and gentlemen, get out your hankies," the singer announced, his amplified voice booming over the valley and echoing back off the wooded hillside. By now, Ellen's sheep had flocked to the farthest corner of the fenced-in pasture, down to the right, where the stream came out of the woods. Ellen imagined the gray coyotes, whose nightly baying she'd been hearing for weeks, slinking down the hill beyond the fences and stream, stalking them. "Because right now, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to get the bride and her father up here on the dance floor." Ellen turned, saw Scott stub his cigar out on the gate, set his drink on top of the cedar post, and start walking toward the canopy. Eyes sparkling, he still maintained some of his youthful charm, his tourmaline stud and black ponytail countering the fullness of his face. Everyone knew he was about to lose his hardware store, this after he'd been one of Destin's most prosperous young men only 10 years ago. But he carried himself with a staunch, countrified dignity as he searched the crowd for his daughter. When he ducked under the canopy and stepped onto the dance floor, Maureen was there waiting, dark eyes staring off dazedly as she reached for him and wrapped her arms around his neck. Daddy's little girl. "You gonna cry?" Maddie asked. Ellen folded her arms, not answering. "I just hope Randy knows how to waltz," Maddie added. Ellen looked askance at her. "Why?" Maddie patted her arm. "He's the groom, and you're the mother of the bride. You're on next," she said, moving off. "Be sweet. I'm going off to do my sultry thing." Ellen turned, spotted Randy sauntering toward the beer keg with his hands stuffed in the back pockets of his leather pants. With his matching leather vest and dark shades and his cropped ponytail, he must have imagined himself swashbuckling. Waltz? Ellen had never even had a real conversation with Randy. Not that she'd made the effort. According to Maureen, Randy had studied art at some community college in Florida, yet now he worked part-time for a sea urchin diver who was also his best man today. On the side, Randy made airbrush paintings depicting endangered animals killing humans. Building up his portfolio, Maureen had explained on the night she told Ellen and Scott she was pregnant. Really? What was there to say to Randy? "I'm so happy that my daughter has chosen you to father her children. And how cool that you wore shades to the wedding, not to mention that little nod you and Scott exchanged when he brought Maureen to the altar." Now, as Ellen watched Scott dancing with their daughter, she wondered again how he'd given his consent so easily while she tried to talk to Mo about adoption and even offered to help raise the child herself to keep Maureen in high school and to keep her from marrying Randy. But the conversations had been cut off each time by Maureen's breezy indifference, by Scott's reluctance to argue. Ellen gazed at her daughter. Dark-haired and beautiful as a pregnant Irish-American girl could be, Maureen had the deep brown eyes of her father, a dusting of freckles on her nose like her mother, and a pretty cherubic mouth that was all her own. Maureen had told Ellen that Randy was an uneducated genius. She said he was sensitive and ambitious and funny, and that he'd be a wonderful father. Maureen told her mother a lot of things. For instance, that the first time in her life she'd ever felt loved was the first time Randy had looked at her. Right now, Randy was at the keg, making another girl feel loved, judging by the way he was allowing her to pick the frosting out of his goatee. She was maybe 15 years old and wore denim shorts ripped off so short they seemed to have no crotch. "Now I'd like to have the groom and the bride's mother join in," the singer announced, snapping Ellen from her reverie. She set her glass down and came forward to the dance floor while she watched Randy wrap his arm around the girl and fill her cup from the keg. The singer leaned into the mic. "Randy, your mother-in-law's waiting for you. Get used to it, man." Some of the men laughed heartily. Some women booed. Randy glanced over at Ellen while he fed the girl her first sip of beer, laughing as it spilled down her chin. Ellen looked toward Maureen, who rolled her eyes as if to say, "Randy is just so independent." Ellen eyed Scott next, wishing he'd rescue her, but he just gave her a look, a shrug. Then a hand touched her back. "Dance with me," the voice said. And before Ellen could decline, her right hand was firmly in the young man's left, and his arm was around her back. His shoulder was solid, as was his arm, his fingers thick and long. His face was symmetrically constructed, his nose straight, his chin square. Though cleanly shaven, she could tell his beard would be heavy in a few hours. She could detect a tinge of fresh perspiration about him, a close, energetic scent. She could feel the champagne she had drunk. "He may not be the groom," the singer announced, "but I don't think you mind, do you, Mom?" Ellen felt her face flush as she glanced up at her partner. He gave her a bemused smile that she took for sympathy. His brown eyes, she noticed, were as dark as Maureen's. "I guess your son-in-law has one redeeming quality," her partner said to her as the small dance floor filled with other couples. "What's that?" "He left you unattended." His smile was warm and easy, and somehow seemed familiar. Then she became aware of fingers spreading on the small of her back, and she felt her heart pump. She inched away from him. "I'm Maureen's mother," she told him. "I know," he said. "Your name is Ellen, and you've been standing over there wondering if it's possible to get away with murder." "Close." Laughing uncomfortably, she hadn't realized her feelings toward Randy were quite so obvious. "Anything's possible," he said quietly. Reflexively, she pulled back another inch to study him to ascertain that he was joking. He gave her another smile. "Are you a friend or relative?" she asked. "Relative, you might say." "Okay," she said, tiring of the game. "Of the bride." Ellen stopped dancing. She pulled her hands from him, his features suddenly snapping together like puzzle pieces. His smile broadened. "It's nice to see you, Aunt Ellen." Ellen embraced him. "Oh, Neil," she said happily. "I wasn't about to miss my only cousin's wedding day," he said, as he took her hand again and they continued dancing. Ellen's heart drumming, her mind whirling, remembering Neil the last time she had seen him at his father's funeral, 2 days after his 12th birthday. Now she held him tightly, suddenly wanting the song to end, wishing Scott was near so she could tell him, "Your nephew Neil is here," then wondering whether to tell Scott at all. "Maureen will be so happy you came," Ellen said. "I wouldn't have recognized her." Ellen sighed, but said nothing. They danced some more while they both absorbed the reunion. "And Uncle Scott, I heard he's still running the hardware store." 15 years now," Ellen said. "Or it's running him." Ellen looked closely at Neil and saw a knowing glint in his eye. "Into the ground," she acknowledged quietly. "I probably should mind my own business," he said. "Anyway, there's another reason I came here today. I didn't know if you heard about my mother." Ellen looked up at him again, then pulled him closer as they kept dancing. "Now that she's gone," he said, "you're the only family I have. You and Uncle Scott and Maureen, and I was hoping we could, you know, exchange Christmas cards at least." "Oh, Neil," she said again, wishing she could think of something else to say, trying to rectify her feelings in the face of the old wounds, the persistent scars. "Mind if I cut in?" asked Scott suddenly at their side, one hand on his nephew's shoulder, the other on Ellen's. Not at all, Neil replied, backing away, giving Ellen the glance of a steadfast ally. She took Scott in her arms, held him in a familiar way, felt the softness of his back as he began moving his knees in time to the music, shuffling his soles across the makeshift plywood floor. Holding up? He asked. Ellen smelled the cigar on his breath, tinged with whiskey. I'll be glad when it's over, she answered. Tell him. It's his past, too, more than mine. He drew her closer. They'll be okay, El. Don't forget, you were the same age when we got married. Have we been okay? She asked pensively. He smiled easily. I think we've been great. She nestled her face against his, relieved to let someone else answer the hard questions. So who were you dancing with? Neil, she answered, just as the song came to an end and the drummer began a faster beat. Friend of Randy's? Maureen's arm around Ellen's neck interrupted them. Ellen let go of Scott, turned, and took her daughter in a hug. Maureen was so drunk that she almost pulled her mother over, and Ellen wanted to admonish her for drinking while she was pregnant, for drinking anyway at her age, but Ellen restrained herself. It was a hug from her daughter, who had grown so distant lately that Ellen relished any connection with her. You look beautiful today, Ellen told her. So do you, Maureen said. Are you happy for me? Ellen pulled her daughter closer. I'm trying, Mo, I really am. Just then, a cry came from the direction of the barn. All three of them turned. Jesus, Scott said, heading for Maddie, who was next to the paddock fence, covering her face with her hands. Ellen recognized Neil standing beside her, though his back was to them. Who is that guy? Maureen asked. As Ellen fell in step with Scott, hurrying to see what had happened, Neil lowered his head and walked away. Ellen reached her friend first. Mad? I'm fine, Maddie told her, even as she rubbed her eyes with her fists. What happened? Scott asked, watching Neil disappear around the front of the barn. I'm fine, Maddie repeated. I touched your electric fence and splashed my drink in my eye. A few other wedding guests gathered around to see what was wrong. She got bit by the fence, that's all, Scott told them. If you want, ma'am, I'll arrest that fence, said Sugar Westerback, the town's only full-time policeman. Then he laughed at his joke along with the other guys. Sugar was built like a hydrant, with massive arms. His hair was shaved within an eighth inch of his skull, and he wore a black, tight-fitting T-shirt that said, Dare to keep kids off drugs, and loose-fitting pants, the kind favored by weightlifters, with a pager hooked to his belt. So glad I can entertain you all, Maddie told him, squeezing her eyes shut. Does anyone have a napkin? Scott pulled a clean handkerchief from his pocket and handed it to her. Sure you're okay? I'm not going to sue, if that's what you mean, Maddie replied, dabbing the corner of her eye. Sugar nudged Scott with his elbow. Scotty, if this fence don't keep them coyotes away from them sheep, that scream of hers sure as hell will. Sugar laughed as he walked away, and as the other men also dispersed, Ellen picked up Maddie's plastic drinking glass a few feet away in the deep grass. I thought it was a very sultry scream, Ellen said to her friend, affectionately. Here he was, all by himself, and I'm coming over doing the walk. Remember Kathleen Turner in Body Heat? And just as I say, you don't have an older brother, do you? I lean against the fence and throw my drink in my face. And you're thinking he wasn't impressed? Ellen said with a smile. Maddie's face changed. She turned and stared at the fence, a realization overtaking her. He was holding on to it. She breathed. Holding what? The fence. The electric fence. He was standing right here, leaning against it, holding it in his hand. Are you sure? Maddie looked up at Ellen in disbelief. The entire time he was standing here, he was baiting me. Even though Ellen found this a little hard to believe, she didn't question her friend. Maddie had always been a little dramatic. Remember Neil? She said. Maddie scowled darkly. Neil, your nephew? Neil, Scott's brother's son. Maddie gave her a look. Does Scott know he's here? Ellen shook her head. Well, I hate to be the one to tell you, kid, but Scott's brother's son could use some serious professional help. And you just happen to know a psychotherapist with free time? Maddie shook her head grimly. Not on your life, she said. That's way more than I can handle. While the crowd was distracted, Neil Chambers walked into the barn. There were stalls running down the left and right walls, with a small dusty window lighting each and a double door on either side of the barn that opened onto the ewes and rams' paddocks. A thick chain and hook hung down from the center beam. As Neil passed under the hook, another young man stepped out of the last stall on the right. "You want something?" the kid said. He was Neil's size and build, possibly a year or two younger. He tipped a bottle of Pabst Blue Ribbon to his mouth in a way that made his biceps flex. Neil continued to approach, saying, "Before I left, I wanted to say goodbye to Randy." The kid cocked his head and drawled, "Better for you to wait outside. He's busy now." But Neil didn't stop. He walked right up to the kid and looked into the stall where Randy was kneeling in front of an overturned wooden crate. The young girl in the denim shorts sat on the crate, her knees pressed against Randy's sides. She looked up vacantly at Neil. Randy glanced over his shoulder. "Good fucking job, Gator," he said. A hypodermic stuck like an arrow in the head of a green hummingbird tattooed on the girl's forearm. A length of slender rubber tubing was tied around her left arm. "It's okay, Randy, I'm Moe's cousin," Neil said, stepping through the narrow doorway of the stall. "I just wanted to say goodbye before I left." Watching Neil closely, Randy left the needle hanging from the girl's arm, reached around behind her, and picked a double-edged razor blade off the crate. "You want to say goodbye?" he said, rising to his feet. Neil came toward him, extending his right hand.
"Randy, finish me,"
the girl protested. Randy stuck out his left hand to shake, still grasping the razor blade in his right.
"One other thing," Neil said as they clasped hands.
"Yeah?"
"Well," Neil said, "I think you need to start showing a little more respect for the family."
At first, Randy didn't react beyond a slight narrowing of his eyes, as if he were trying to read the glint in Neil's eye. Then the corners of Randy's goatee lifted in a kind of grin. He blinked his eyes once, twice, and all at once he snapped Neil's hand around and laid the razor blade flat against the pale underside of Neil's wrist. Timing.
"Stay very still, cousin," Randy whispered, stealing his grip on Neil's hand to make his point. "Very, very still, 'cause now I have something to tell you."
"Randy, are you gonna finish me?"
the girl complained, pushing limply to her feet. Gator snickered, leering over the stall at her. A bright speck of red winked on Neil's wrist where the point of Randy's blade touched his skin. Neither man saw the blood, however, intent as they were on each other's eyes. Neither did they see Gator sidling into the stall with a 3-inch punch blade protruding from his fist.
"See, I don't know what your actual problem is," Randy said to Neil. "Fact is, maybe I didn't even hear you right."
"Randy,"
the girl sang again, knees bending, holding the syringe in her forearm so it wouldn't fall out. With the hand that held the punch blade, Gator reached out and caught the girl's breast between his thumb and finger. As she let go of the syringe to clutch at his wrist, he plucked the syringe from her arm.
"You're a little brat,"
Gator said, giving her nipple a twist until she rose onto her toes. "Anyone ever teach you not to interrupt?" Tears welled in the girl's eyes. Then he released her. She staggered backward into the doorpost.
"Asshole,"
she screamed. Gator jumped at her with his punch blade and she ran out of the stall. Then turning back to Randy and Neil, Gator raised the syringe upright in his hand and tapped the barrel with his ring finger. squeezing the punch blade in his other hand until the veins on his arm rose fat and blue, he carefully sank the needle into his bloodstream and pushed the plunger. He hissed through his teeth as the drug went in, all the while studying Neil and Randy.
"Well then," Gator said, tossing the syringe on the floor, "looks like we got ourselves somebody else that needs a lesson in politeness."
He pushed himself off the rough boarded wall and ambled closer to them both, pale eyes shining intently until he stopped arm's length from Neil, staring at his neck the same way he had stared at the girl's breast. But even as Gator's punch blade flashed with the window's reflection, Neil kept his eyes fixed on Randy.
"Yep," Gator said. "Seems like nowadays everybody's forgetting their manners."
"Hey!" Suddenly Gator jerked backward, snagged in the oversized hand of a very tall man who had silently entered the barn behind him and yanked him out of the stall. It was Rooftop Paradise, Randy's boss and best man, and he seemed annoyed at Randy.
"This is a wedding,"
he scolded, ducking back into the stall. Suddenly Randy flinched. He looked down at his razor blade, one corner of which had sunk between the bones of Neil's wrist, while the opposite corner had thrust up into his own index finger. Dumbfounded, Randy watched the blood well up out of both of them, then he returned his eyes to Neil's steady stare.
"You some kind of mental case?"
"What the heck are you doing in here?" Rooftop demanded of his friend.
"What does it look like?" Randy answered sourly. "I'm having a discussion with an asshole."
Rooftop turned to Neil and asked quietly,
"Your business done here?"
Neil's eyes left Randy's but didn't meet Rooftop's. Instead, they tracked Gator sneaking into the stall again, his punch blade peeking out of his fist.
"I said behave, you,"
Rooftop told Gator, his long right arm swinging back, stopping him short.
"And you," Rooftop said, returning his attention to Randy, "it's your wedding day. You're supposed to be out there with your wife."
"Fuck,"
Randy said. Rooftop turned to Neil again.
"Okay now?"
"I think I made my point," Neil replied, backing into the cobwebbed corner of the stall, casually taking a handkerchief from his pocket and pressing it against his wrist, though his eyes remained keenly focused on the three men in front of him. Randy tried to flick the razor blade off his bloody fingers.
"Dipshit,"
he said, finally flinging it toward Neil's legs.
"Stick around. Maybe you can give me some more marital advice later on when we won't be interrupted."
Rooftop peered down at the floor through wire-rimmed glasses that looked tiny on his face. He slid his huge wingtip forward and towed the syringe out of the hay, then bent his head toward Randy.
"What the heck is this?"
"How should I know?" Randy answered. "It's a sheep barn. Probably some vet left it."
He did not make eye contact with Rooftop, who was staring at him. Then the giant took a clean handkerchief from his back pocket and stuffed it in Randy's hand.
"I don't know what that little girl was doing in here, but she's young enough to get all you guys locked up,"
said Rooftop gravely.
"Now go take care of that hand."
"Since when did Ann Landers die and put you in charge?"
Randy grumbled, wrapping his finger with the handkerchief.
"Cop coming,"
Gator said, quietly, sticking his head back in the door.
"Mind your manners,"
Rooftop said, pointing a long finger first at Randy, then Gator. Then he turned toward Neil, accidentally gouging his shoulder on a nail sticking out of the ceiling.
"If you were planning to leave," he said, "I'd go ahead with my plans."
Then he ducked out of the stall. Sugar Westerback stood about 10 feet inside the barn with his hands on his hips, watching the three men come toward him.
"Hey, we had a little girl come running out of here a minute ago, all upset about something," he said. "You boys know anything about that?"
He looked down at the bloody handkerchief in Randy's hand. Randy held up the injured finger. "Old barn," he said, "nail sticking out every which way." He grinned at Sugar, though the ever-present scowl seemed to deepen on his brow.
"So you boys don't know anything about the girl," Sugar said. Randy shrugged, then nodded to his two cohorts. "My associates were just giving me some pointers on my wedding night." "I had to take that cake knife away from that girl," Sugar said. "She had it in for somebody."
"Not me,"
Randy said, and started walking toward the door.
As they proceeded toward the daylight, Gator moved around behind the policeman, his right hand buried in his pocket. Rooftop inserted himself furtively between the two.
"Dare to keep kids off drugs," Randy recited, reading Sugar's T-shirt. "That's me," Sugar said, turning back. "I go into the schools dressed up in a dog suit, talk to them about drugs."
Gator snickered.
"But you know what's funny? When I got in my car, pot, about this much."
He spread his thumb and finger an inch apart.
"I show the kids what it looks like, you know, in case somebody offers them any, they'll know enough to turn it down."
"That's good," Randy said as they emerged into the sunlight. "You keep this fucking town safe."
"That's exactly what I do," Sugar said, and he gave Randy a wink.
"So I'd watch myself, if I were you assholes." Chapter 2. For Ellen, the last week before summer vacation seemed endless. Home in the afternoons, she worked in her garden, picking rocks, preparing the soil for another planting of green beans and late corn. On Tuesday, a customer came by and bought two brown fleeces at $16 a pound, and she was able to make a payment on her phone bill. With shearing behind her and her spring lambs almost ready for weaning, the sheep required little of her time besides feeding and watering. At 5 o'clock every day, she went into her pantry where her weights were set up and put herself through a brutal workout. Where normally she'd lift every other day for 40 minutes, this week she worked out every day for an hour. She also raised her bench weight from 120 pounds to 125. The exhaustion did her good. Evenings, she graded final exams and filled out report cards in the kitchen, and if she finished at a reasonable hour, she'd go up to her spinning room and work on her tapestry, a seascape commissioned by a Portsmouth interior decorator. As much as possible, she filled her time with work that enabled her to avoid the living room. In fact, she avoided Scott, and she was aware of this. At first, she thought it was Maureen's glaring absence, the reason she preferred her solitude. But there was more to it. Even on the weekend, she had barely spoken to Scott when they awoke in the morning or passed in the kitchen. Maybe she didn't want to tell him about how it felt to be grading papers of kids who were Maureen's age and planning for college when Maureen was pregnant, married, and gone. Maybe she didn't want to confront her husband about his cavalier attitude in giving their daughter away. Or maybe she was afraid she might tell him what she'd been thinking, that without Maureen home to care for, there wasn't a whole lot keeping her there anymore. No matter. He never asked her what was wrong, so she kept it to herself. But on Sunday afternoon, a week after the wedding, when she went into the pasture and found her oldest ewe bloodied and sprawled on the crest of the hill, Ellen's cry rang full of her frustration. It also sparked a movement below them that she spotted with a heart-thumping start. Coyotes, three of them, gray as sticks, slinking down at the far right corner of the pasture where they'd gotten through the fence. Timid as coyotes tended to be, these must have been famished beyond reason the way they stood their ground once they'd seen her. Ellen glanced behind her at the rest of her sheep tightly flocked in the paddock. She turned back to the coyotes, realized they were edging up the hill toward her. She thought of Scott's revolver in the bedroom, but was afraid to leave her sheep to fetch it. For the first time this week, she wished Scott was here. "Go on," she shouted, tearing off her baseball cap and waving it at the predators. The dying ewe raised its head, and Ellen put her hand on its bloody shoulder, then saw the blood-saturated grass under its belly. Halfway up the hill, with seeming calculation, the coyotes separated. Bowing their heads, fixing their yellow-brown eyes on Ellen, they spread left and right. Ellen raised herself high on her knees, although she realized that the visage she presented was hardly threatening, a woman in a green tank top and frayed jean shorts, her only weapon a baseball cap. Hearing the familiar diesel engine up on the road, she was almost afraid to hope it was Scott, but to her relief, the old Mercedes pulled into their driveway. She waited until the door closed, then she called for him. When he didn't answer, she yelled louder. "Hold your horses," he yelled back. She could hear in his voice that he was wounded by her week of silence. "Get the gun," she cried. As if understanding her words, the coyotes stopped and sniffed the air.
"Where are you?"
Scott shouted.
Down here, get the gun. Scott came to the paddock fence.
What's the matter?
She pointed down the hill. Coyotes!
Ellie, get out of there!
But Ellen wasn't about to leave her sheep. Besides, as close as the coyotes were, and as bold, she had a better chance standing and fighting than turning and running. Scott remained at the fence, holding his briefcase, as if wondering whether or not to just charge down after the predators barehanded. Instead, he turned and ran for the house. Katie, the bloodied ewe, let out a mournful bleat and tried to get up again. Ellen held her down. She knew the animal could smell her killers nearing. Then Scott's voice called out, "Ellie, where the hell did you hide the bullets?" Ellen shouted back, "In the freezer!" She looked toward the coyotes again. Seeing them resume their skulking ascent up the hill, she got to her feet, presenting her full height, grateful for the additional half-inch her work boots provided. She raised her arms over her head. The coyotes balked. Ellen looked back as the side door of the barn opened against the sheep pressed together there, and Scott came marching through their midst, holding the revolver at his shoulder. Seeing him, the lead coyote hunched his bony shoulders and lowered his head. Scott stopped walking, straightened his arm, and aimed. The animal's ears went back. The gun fired. The coyote wheeled and raced toward the corner of the pasture. Scott ran a few steps, then got off a second shot. A divot sprayed up to the left of one of the remaining two animals, and they, too, bolted for the gully. When Scott reached the crest of the hill, right in front of Ellen, he fired again, three times, the echo of his shots slapping back off the opposite hill as the trio pushed under the livestock fence and disappeared into the tangled gray shadows of the stream bank. "Nice shot," Scott said sarcastically to himself. Ellen knelt beside Katie, running her fingers gently over the stiff, cropped wool beside her ear. Scott turned toward her, blowing a sigh that was tinged with frustration. "Want me to call Merrifield, see if he can fix her?" Before she could answer, Ellen noticed that Scott's ponytail was gone. In fact, his hair had been barber-cut and parted neatly down the center, and he was wearing what appeared to be a uniform, light blue blazer, red necktie. An insignia embroidered on his breast pocket read, "Mainly Hardware," under which grinned a dancing stick figure holding a hammer in one hand and a pipe wrench in the other. "I'm buying into the franchise," Scott said, responding to her stare. "First thing they said, no earring, no ponytail." He raised his brow in a show of futility. She could tell he'd been drinking. Ellen looked off beyond him. Scott must have seen a change in her eyes because he turned and stared. "Who's that?" They watched the young man duck under the electric fence and come steadily down the hill, black hair, black sweater, black corduroy jeans. "Do we know him?" In her week of silence, Ellen hadn't mentioned Neil's presence at the wedding. "It looks like Neil," she said now, fitting her cap back on her head and pulling a loose strand of hair behind her ear. "The kid from the wedding?" Scott asked. "Neil," she said flatly, "your brother's son." Scott turned fully toward the barn, peering off against the low sun. When he looked back at Ellen again, he was still squinting as if trying to register too many facts through too much whiskey. "Wolves?" Neil called as he came. Scott watched him with a scowl. "Coyotes," Ellen replied. "Neil?" "Hello, Uncle Scott," Neil said. "If you want to go after them, we'd have better luck with a shotgun." Scott reached the pistol behind him, tucking it in his waistband. "Jesus Christ," he said, grabbing Neil's hand, grinning, then looked at Ellen again, his face registering the reasons she hadn't told him.
"Pistol's the only gun we have," Ellen explained to Neil.
"You want to go after them?" Neil asked again.
"Nah, we'd better get the sheep to the vet," Scott said. "I'll bring Ellie's truck down."
Neil knelt beside the animal, placing his hand gently under its shoulder and raising it a little. He laid his face on the ground and peered underneath the sheep, then said matter-of-factly, "You can't save her."
"You don't know Jake Merrifield," Scott told him. "For $50, he'll bring the dead back to life."
Neil got to his feet again, shaking his head. "They've opened her gut."
He turned to Ellen as though for her decision, and she became aware that, bending over the sheep, her tank top was open to him.
She straightened, kneeling upright. "Neil's right," she said to Scott. "She's dying." "Want me to bring her to Justin?" Scott asked, consolation in his voice. "Justin Briscoe, the butcher," he explained to Neil. Ellen shook her head. "They might have had rabies."
"Not likely," Neil replied. "Rabid animals travel alone."
He reached behind him and withdrew a knife from a sheath, a 4-inch blade with a worn leather handle.
"At least we can save the pelt."
"Wait." Ellen rose to her feet.
"Go up to the house if you want," Neil said, "but we need to take care of her. She's suffering."
Scott pulled the revolver from his waistband.
"Scott!"
"Elle, go on up to the house," he told her gently, then said to Neil, "This is the only thing she lets me do on the farm, but she hates me when I do it." He placed the barrel behind Katie's ear, but Neil reached out and touched his hand.
"The other sheep are spooked enough," Neil said, taking the revolver from Scott and handing it to Ellen. "I've done this before. Lift her by the hind legs, backside to you."
Scott looked down at his blazer.
"Quickly," Neil said.
Scott, nonplussed, nevertheless stooped and got his arms around the animal's flanks. He grunted once as he raised the sheep off the ground. Neil knelt in front of the ewe and held the back of its head. Ellen felt her knees shiver. Neil looked up at her.
"Okay?"
She nodded. Although she had never watched when Scott put down one of her sick or injured animals, there seemed something less offensive about Neil's doing it. His questioning look on her lingered. She nodded again. Then he turned back to the sheep, threaded his knife blade carefully through the wool at her throat. "Hold her still," he said softly to Scott.
"Got her,"
Scott replied. Neil's arm barely moved. The sheep kicked once, and Ellen saw the dark blood gulp over Neil's thumb before she turned and left them, walking quickly toward the barn. She moved through her flock, hiding the still warm revolver under her arm, then hurried through the paddock, across the dusty dooryard, and onto the porch into her kitchen, where she closed the door behind her, wondering why she had stayed to watch. She went into the pantry, stepped around her weights, and slid the pistol on top of the cupboard, then returned to the kitchen where she washed the ewe's blood off her hands, then sat at the table and unlaced her boots, pulled off her wool socks. Through the open windows, she could hear Scott's voice out in the barn, the dull clatter of the chain being dragged across the same wooden beam that Neil's father had used to hang himself. She went into the bathroom, stripped off her top and shorts, and stepped into the shower, lathered and rinsed herself thoroughly, wanting to wash away every trace of Katie's death. When she was through, she wrapped a bath towel around herself and went upstairs to dress, putting on a crisp, white, long-sleeved shirt and pair of faded jeans, wide leather belt. She rolled up her shirt cuffs and returned downstairs to the pantry, where she kicked a 10-pound dumbbell out of her way and took some frozen lamb chops out of the old chest freezer. Putting down an animal now and then was part of farming, she told herself. All part of farming. The screen door opened.
"That sheep did not feel pain, I guarantee it," Scott said, tossing his new blue blazer on the kitchen table. His khaki slacks glistened red and brown. He seemed to study her.
"Take off your pants," she said. "I'll throw them in the wash." The old linoleum felt cool under her feet.
"You okay?" he asked her.
"I've had better days," she answered, even though there was more to his question than her slaughtered sheep. They both knew it.
"Toss me a couple of brewskis," he said.
Ellen opened the refrigerator, found two cans of Pabst, and put them in his hands. He smelled of sheep, of fresh blood. It bothered her, the thought of them drinking beer over Katie's carcass, but she didn't say so.
"Neil's got some ideas about the barn," Scott said, going back out the door, his pants riding low on his hips.
Ellen followed him out, went around the side of the house to her salad garden, where she picked some spinach and chives, then returned to the kitchen to rinse them.
"Amazing," Scott said, coming in again behind her. "I mean, it was like he was putting her to sleep."
You told me. Scott unzipped his pants and stepped out of them as he went into the bathroom. He turned on the shower. Then, with the water running, he opened the bathroom door again.
I invited him for dinner, Scott told her, standing there in his jockeys. I didn't think you'd mind.
She took a knife from the maple holder. Scott, you never told me about the franchise.
It's business, he said. I didn't tell anyone.
He went back into the bathroom and showered, then came out with a towel wrapped around him.
You know, Neil's a carpenter by trade. He's built a couple of barns before, post and beam. He's got pictures, beautiful.
Ellen started cutting the chives, her back to him. A moment passed.
Al, is this hard for you? He asked. I mean, Neil's showing up?
It's not hard for me. She kept the knife moving.
Maybe it's a little uncomfortable for me.
Maybe it is. Should be. Chop, chop.
He looks so much like my brother.
I thought he looked like April. Scott paused. Ellen could feel his eyes on her.
Anyway, he said, he's between jobs, and he was talking about fixing up the barn. Actually, building us a new one.
Ellen stopped cutting.
He says it'll take less than 2 weeks. We buy materials, give him room and board, that's all he wants.
Ellen turned. Scott, where are we going to get money for lumber? We can't pay the bills we've got.
Hey, he said, scratching at his new haircut. We're middle class now. I get a salary.
It was hard to ignore the defeat in his voice. You still haven't told me where you got the money to buy into the franchise, she said.
Al, how does any business get money? I took out a loan.
With our credit?
It's not important. Look, you've been telling me for years the barn's falling in.
But have him stay here?
Moe's room is empty. Why not?
Ellen took a breath and let it out.
I didn't give him a definite answer, Scott said. I told him I'd talk to you.
Ellen scooped the cut chives into her hand, sprinkled them over the spinach, then brushed her hands together over the salad bowl. She chose her words with care.
Scott, if this is your way of making up to him, free labor, that's all it is.
Scott took his beer off the counter and took a long swig, then tossed the empty can in the wastebasket.
That's what the silent treatment was about, right? Neil shows up and you get a chance to crucify me a little more.
Scott, you brought Katie into the barn and hung her from the beam, Ellen said, with Neil standing right there.
Footsteps on the porch silenced them as Neil appeared outside the screen door looking in.
Here he is, Scott said, finding a welcoming grin. Come on in, man.
He threw the door open and Neil caught it, then stood awkwardly in the doorway, wearing a black T-shirt, his black sweater bunched in his hand. His arms, Ellen noticed, were long and sinewy, like a swimmer's. His neck and shoulders looked strong, a far cry from the boy she remembered.
Name your poison, Scott said, opening the refrigerator. Another brew?
Neil lingered at the threshold, looking in at Ellen.
Maybe I picked a bad time.
Scott waved his hand.
Don't be crazy. Come in. Hey, show her the picture of the barn you built. I've almost got her talked into it.
Ellen gave Scott a warning look, but he pretended not to notice.
Seriously, he said. Ellie and I need to talk it over. Have dinner with us. Tonight you can sleep in Moe's bed. In the morning, we'll have a decision for you.
Neil looked at Ellen again, checking for consent. She smiled at him. The smile he returned was tinged with sadness or sympathy. She served broiled lamb chops along with the spinach salad and some fresh baked rolls. She used her good stoneware, and Neil ate heartily. To Ellen, the meals seemed like those when they'd first bought the farm from Scott's parents, and Maureen was just learning to walk. The old farm kitchen was meant for meals like this, with its cast-iron cook stove and old oak chairs.
So, Neil, Scott said. He was working on his second whiskey and ginger. Where did you learn so much about sheep and barns and things?
When I was 14, Neil answered, I spent a summer on a sheep farm in Vermont and helped them build a barn. It's basic stuff.
What were you doing in Vermont? Helen said. I thought you moved to Massachusetts.
The state sent me off to boarding school when I was 13. I don't know if you heard, they checked Mom into the hospital. She had a little breakdown. Well, more than one.
Helen studied his face, thinking of her own mother.
Stupid goddamn thing, Scott interjected. He was turned in his chair, looking at his blazer folded on top of the washing machine. Mainly hardware. Isn't that clever? Mainly bullshit.
Neil laughed a little.
So, Uncle Scott, when's the grand opening? Hold on, Scott said, laying his fork on the table. If you're going to live here, you can't be calling me uncle.
Ellen caught his eye, annoyed that he was acting as if it were already settled that Neil would move in. She got up from the table and started collecting the dishes. Scott crumpled up his napkin and tossed it at her.
Come on, hon, you know you want that barn. He turned to Neil with a grin. See, she refuses to look at the picture.
And there it was. The snapshot already stuck to the refrigerator with a Destin hardware magnet, a beautiful building, tall and stately and bone white against the dark green hills, almost church-like in the way its silo rose up above the peak. Hearing the silence in the room, Ellen turned to see both men watching her.
You know you want it, Scott teased.
She laughed a little as she shook her head.
Like a couple of little boys, she said, although she realized she'd made up her mind the minute she heard the suggestion. Neil, I'd love you to stay here and rebuild the barn.
Scott responded by sitting back in his chair, turning and giving Neil a wink. Neil smiled, but kept an uncertain eye on Ellen.
So what's for dessert? Scott said.
Yesterday's rhubarb pie, Ellen answered. Neil, would you care for some?
Maybe later, Neil said, sliding his chair back. I want to get started on the barn tonight. Hold on, I'll give you a hand, Scott said.
Know how to handle a hammer? Neil asked, straight-faced.
Hey, Scott said, mainly hardware, serving Maine's hardware needs.
Ellen, thanks for dinner, Neil said. It was wonderful.
Very wonderful, Scott added.
Yeah, she said, waving them off.
Despite her slight annoyance at the way Scott had steamrolled her, Ellen felt good about how the two men were getting along. Still, she couldn't help but wonder just how much Neil knew about his uncle, or the day his father died.
Chapter 3. Next left.
Rooftop Paradise said, and Randy turned the dark panel truck onto the Phipps Road, its headlights sweeping over the dark green woods. A magnetic sign attached to the side of the vehicle read, XYZ Divers. Diving is our business. But tonight, 15 miles inland, the men were not looking for water. Rooftop moonlighted as a collection agent for Ray LaFlamme, a 72-year-old financier who owned the Bell Atlantic restaurant in Old Orchard Beach. LaFlamme's philosophy was simple. Property in southern Maine, particularly around the southern coast, was gold. Although he owned thousands of acres of it, he knew there were still farmers who owned thousands more. And there wasn't a farmer alive who wasn't in some kind of financial dung heap. LaFlamme would lend them as much money as they wanted, for whatever reason. At 20% interest, what did he care? As long as they put up their property as collateral.
Turn left up at the curve, Rooftop said. Then look for a big potato barn and a burned-out foundation.
Randy worked for Rooftop in both ventures, collections and diving. Not that Randy had any particular expertise in either. Randy had signed on a year ago, right after Rooftop finished a 3-year stint in Thomaston State Prison and resumed these particular lines of work. He
He had served time for a drunk driving, resisting arrest conviction in which the oversized young man had taken 2 bullets in the thigh and another in the chest and still managed to send 4 state troopers to the emergency room. Their assignment tonight was not a collection, per se, but what Rooftop liked to call an encouragement session, meaning after it was over, the borrower would seriously consider signing his deed over to LaFlamme. A couple of guys named Humphrey and Jimmy Burdock, who lived in a trailer on 60 acres of land in Elliott, had borrowed $40,000 from LaFlamme to start a company, and they still hadn't made their first payment, which was not all that surprising, given that the product they were attempting to market was pickled French fries. By the time the assignment reached Rooftop through one of LaFlamme's bodyguards, the message was garbled and vague, but the upshot was they'd get an even $400 for a routine 10-second beating. And $400 more if the session resulted in a deed transfer.
2 of them. Maybe we should have brought Gatorade along, Randy suggested as he turned onto the old road.
I don't know, Rooftop said. That gator's pretty bad. I think he gets a thrill out of hurting people.
What, like you don't?
Rooftop ignored Randy. He leaned forward in his seat, watching the mobile home slide past them, sitting in front of a pair of white block chimneys. A huge barn sat behind everything with a satellite dish high on its roof. A wooden, hand-painted sign banged into the front lawn said, Burdock's Famous Frickles, Live Bait, Wedding Cakes.
Frickles, Rooftop said. That was the place.
Wedding cakes? Randy added with a smirk. Probably a couple of faggots. Hey, I'll pound faggots for free.
Actually, I think these guys are brothers, Rooftop said. They got the same last name.
Whatever, they borrow $40,000 from Ray LaFlamme and then blow it all gambling. They deserve a pounding.
Rooftop shrugged.
Some people can't control their instincts.
Fuck, then they burn down their own house for the insurance money and the fire investigators find 3 points of origin. They deserve a beating just for being so stupid. Besides which, pickled French fries?
Randy drove to the dead end of the road, where he turned the van around, then stepped on the emergency brake. He looked over at Rooftop and said,
What do you do it for?
Do what?
Fuck people up.
I don't believe I ever hurt a person for fun, Rooftop said, even when I used to drink.
Randy snorted.
So how come you're still working for LaFlamme?
Rooftop stared straight at him.
Mr. LaFlamme helped my mother put me through St. Joseph's. I'm paying him back for my education. That's the only reason I do it. Plus, sometimes I feel like I'm educating others in return.
Randy smirked.
Gatorade will educate your ass, he said. Doctorate in pain.
They shared the rearview mirror and straightened their hair. Sometimes they'd pretend to be Jehovah's Witnesses, but in neighborhoods like this, you never knew, the people answering the doors might be witnesses themselves. Not to mention these guys might have wives or kids living there who could go for the gun while the old man was busy getting beaten. One thing Rooftop had learned, people that lived in places like that, with the junk cars and mud-strewn yards and no trespassing signs, they always had guns. Some of them were fearsomely dumb, some were downright crazy, and you never knew which wayward relative might be lurking in the shadows.
I don't give Gator much in terms of life expectancy, Rooftop said as they got out of the van. Personally speaking, I wouldn't be associated with him if he wasn't related to Mr. LaFlamme.
Who isn't related to Ray LaFlamme? Randy said, sliding the side door open. Some alcoholic bastard third cousin got a stepson in Baton Rouge, Louisiana, supposedly swallowed by alligators escaping from his chain gang, and we get to train his crazy ass.
Like I said, Rooftop told him, I got a debt to Mr. LaFlamme. If he says show the kid the ropes, that's what I do.
He lifted the carpet and pulled out the pair of magnetic signs that said Maine State Lottery Commission and stuck one to the side of the van. Randy took the other sign and stuck it to the other side. Then they got back in.
You know what I think? Randy said as they drove back to the trailer. I think LaFlamme's grooming the gator for bigger things.
What bigger things?
I don't know exactly, but I got a very dark feeling, Randy said.
He shifted into neutral and stepped on the parking brake.
Call it a premonition.
They left the motor running while they walked to the trailer and climbed the two porch steps. Randy reached in his jacket pocket and took out a small green jalapeno pepper and popped it in his mouth while Rooftop knocked on the aluminum door. June bugs and spindle-legged flying insects bounced off the bare yellow light bulb. Chewing the jalapeno, Randy's eyes watered, his cheeks reddened. When the door opened, he smiled warmly, as if he was about to make this guy rich. But it was a woman who stood there, wearing a blue threadbare bathrobe, possibly the smallest woman Randy had ever seen. Not that she was a dwarf, but she definitely looked undernourished. Her hair hung straight to her shoulders. Her eyes were ringed with dark, concentric circles. In fact, one eye was bruised, as though she'd been punched. Her cheeks were hollow. She could have been 70, could have been 25. A cigarette glowed between her fingers. "What are you guys going fishing? Need worms?" she said, squinting up at them. Case like this, Rooftop would usually detain the wife while Randy walked inside and did his business with the old man. Rooftop hated doing that, the way some of these wives fought. He was afraid of accidentally breaking their arms.
"Is Humphrey or Jimmy at home?" he asked.
Sweat ran down Randy's forehead. He looked back over his shoulder, working up a fiery saliva as he checked the dark road.
"Right here, I'm Jimmy. What do you want?"
the woman said, her speech a rapid-fire burst of syllables. She peered out at their van.
"What's this, I win some kind of gimmick or what?"
Rooftop looked at Randy, then back at the woman. In all the jobs he did for Ray LaFlamme, he'd never had to collect from a woman. He said,
"I thought Jimmy was a man's name."
"No friggin' man around here."
"No Humphrey?"
"You're looking for Humphrey, you can find him on the gambling ferry tomorrow night," the woman said. "And when you do, you can tell him for me. I don't want him back."
Randy didn't say anything. Just hauled off and spat a greenish spray in the miniature woman's eyes, then followed with a quick, hard punch to the face. Rooftop saw one of her bony feet lift out of her slipper as she shot out of sight. Rooftop gaped at his partner, amazed, then looked into the trailer where the woman was sprawled in her kitchen, just starting to move. Her cigarette smoldered on the floor beside her. "For crying out loud," Rooftop said to Randy. Then he ducked into the kitchen, picked up the cigarette, and dropped it in the sink. Turning back to help the woman up, he saw that she'd already pulled herself onto one elbow. Blood ran thinly from her nose down her cheek and lips, but she seemed more concerned with her burning eyes, squinting and rubbing them with her flimsy bathrobe sleeve like a raccoon washing itself.
"Dirty bastard," she slurred.
"Never mind that," Rooftop told her. "You need to take responsibility for your financial obligations."
He stooped and gently lifted her to a sitting position. Indeed, she weighed about as much as a raccoon.
"See, when you borrow money from a man and don't pay him back, you might as well be stealing from him," he said to her. "Now you people have missed your second payment, which means you owe Ray LaFlamme $5,000 plus $600 in late fees. I don't think anyone's going to complain if you pay half now and half on the weekend."
The woman replied, reaching her skinny hand into the pocket of her bathrobe.
"This'd be cash, not check," Rooftop explained,
but then he saw that what she pulled out of her pocket was not a checkbook or cash, but a tiny revolver. And he ducked his head and charged out the door, knocking into Randy on his own way out just as the shooting started. Bang, 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 bang. She fired the gun the way she talked, all six shots popping off before the men had made it down the steps.
"You hit?" Rooftop said as they jumped in the van.
"No. You?"
"No."
"Christ, who keeps a gun in their bathrobe?"
Randy said, ramming the shift into D and screeching the tires on the road. Rooftop looked back at the trailer's lights as the van tore up the country road.
"That's what I call paranoid," Randy said. "She in pursuit?"
"No."
Randy checked his rear view. "Want to go back?"
"What the heck for?
I only hit her the once."
Rooftop shook his head.
"Once was once too much for a lady. What's the matter with you?"
"Some lady," Randy said. "Friggin' witch, if you ask me. We best get home anyway. I don't want the wife asking a lot of questions. I told her we had to dive in the dark tonight so we wouldn't upset the sea turtles."
"What are you going to tell her about tomorrow? Looks like we'll be spending the night on a gambling ferry."
"I don't know, some story. Dumb bitch believes anything I tell her."
Rooftop gave him a look, kept right on looking at him until Randy said, "You got a problem?" While Scott and Neil worked on the barn, Ellen folded laundry and finished her report cards, then made her way up to her spinning room. She had two looms and a spinning wheel in the room, the smaller loom for her commissioned pieces, the larger one for her art. Tonight she sat at the large loom. She'd been creating the tapestry for almost 2 years now and hoped it would be done by summer's end. It was her homage to parents, hers and Scott's, all of whom had died in recent years. As soon as she began, she lost herself in her work, lulled by the sounds of the night, the water falling over the dam, an occasional sheep crying, its bell ringing, the creaking and banging of her barn coming down. She had worked for 3 hours or more when she realized that the hammering had stopped and the men were downstairs talking softly. Only vaguely aware of dishes and silverware ringing or the footsteps on the stairs, she didn't even hear the door open behind her. "You are amazing." Startled, Ellen turned to see Neil standing there, staring over her shoulder at the tapestry. Now she heard Scott snoring across the hall in their bedroom. "I plug away," she said. "You plug away," Neil replied, gently mocking her modesty. "That's a museum piece." Ellen smiled, unsure how to respond. It was a wide tapestry, 4 feet wide and nearly 5 feet high. Centered in the work was a scene from an old photo of her mother crouched beside a sand sculpture in the Ogunquit Dunes on a misty day. Her mother, an artist, had spent the entire day working on the sculpture, an Indian woman lying on her back watching the stars. Ellen's woven image was done in undyed wool, the natural browns, blacks, and off-whites of her flock, made to resemble an old sepia-toned print. In both the photo and the tapestry, Ellen's mother appeared uncomfortable posing. She had been 36 at the time, Ellen's age, and quite beautiful. But while her sculpture gazed skyward, her own head remained bowed, self-consciously. "How many hours do you have in this?" Neil asked. Ellen shrugged. "I haven't counted." "And I thought you were so practical."
"I am, about most things."
"Is this your mom?" he asked, pointing.
"Yeah, she was a sculptor, metals mostly. She died a few years ago, choked on a piece of candy."
Ellen laughed a little, bitterly.
"A lemon sour ball."
Neil was silent for a moment. Ellen went on. "I'm sure she always thought she'd be struck by lightning." "I hope you don't mind the interrogation," Neil said. Ellen shrugged off his concern. "I'm flattered that you're interested." Along the top quarter of the tapestry, where Ellen had yet to inlay the shed, the bottoms of 5 sepia-toned wheels showed. In the top right-hand corner, the lower half of a full yellow moon sat in a black night sky. Ellen had made the yellow dye with the skins of onions she had grown. The entire bottom border was a frozen lake. A jagged break in the ice revealed swirls of creamy white water. From the left and right corners grew gnarled, bare-limbed trees that crackled upward like flames, the tops of which protruded through the central image as dune grass. "White water?" Neil ventured. "The reservoir, where Scott's parents were killed." "They drowned?" Ellen nodded. "Christmas morning. Your grandmother was helping Raleigh deliver his milk. She did that every Christmas. It was snowing and his truck slid off the road." "So that's going to be the milk truck," Neil guessed, pointing to the pair of wheels on the upper left, where 4 butterflies, the small wooden crosses around which were wound different hued yarn, hung from the unfinished image. Ellen nodded. Neil touched another butterfly, one that hung from a larger wheel in the center of the design. "This is going to be a spinning wheel?"
"Scott's mother, your grandma Chambers, she taught me to spin and weave."
"And," moving his finger to the right,
"my mother's motorcycle, an old BMW.
"So tell me," he said, putting his hand on her shoulder and tapping the yellow butterfly with his long finger, setting it gently swinging, "is this the moon or the sour ball your mother choked on?"
"I haven't figured that out yet," Ellen said, turning to look up at him. "It's almost funny, isn't it?" she asked grimly.
"Not at all," he said. His hand remained on her shoulder, and his dark eyes met hers intently. Then, abruptly, he removed his hand and stuck both hands in his pockets, showing some discomfort. Ellen, I feel like you were coerced into letting me stay here. She shook her head dismissively. I just don't handle surprises well, she told him. But your family, Neil, you're always welcome here. I may be Scott's family, he said. As far as you're concerned, I'm just the son of someone who used to be your brother-in-law. Whoever you are, she replied, conceding the point with a smile, I'm glad you came. He returned her smile easily. So am I, he said. But he seemed to study her. Neil, how long do you think it'll take, realistically? Ellen asked, hoping he wouldn't mistake her question for eagerness to have him finish and be gone. She just needed to know how long he'd be there so she could prepare herself emotionally. Feeling disjointed as she did with Maureen's departure, she still wasn't sure this was a good idea, having him here. Realistically, he said, 12 days. 12? Was he teasing her? She met his eyes again. 12, he repeated. Why? She shook her head. You seem very confident, that's all. Neil shrugged. What can I say? This is the 1st of July. I'll be done on the 12th. He gave her a last look, a kind of polite smile. Well, I guess I'll leave you alone and try to get some sleep, he said. And he left the room. Night, Ellen said, hoping she hadn't insulted him. When Ellen got into bed, Scott stopped snoring. He lay still for a moment, then rolled over to face her. He's just like his father was, another Superman, he said. Supposedly he's going to help me, too. Help you what? Scott smirked. With the business. I thought mainly hardware would be making all the decisions now. Hey, between them and Neil, how can I go wrong? Shh. Their bedroom door was closed. Ellen could see the light under the door. She had left Moe's bedroom light on for Neil. She glanced at the clock, 1:11. She rolled over to face Scott, ran her fingers through the soft warmth of his chest hairs. He covered her wrist with his hand. She could feel his heart beating. Scott, he's your family, she said quietly. If you'd rather not have him here, tell him we've changed our minds. Scott sighed. I've got to admit, the kid's a hell of a worker, he said. Incredible energy. Ellen softened her voice to a whisper. I didn't tell you what Maddie said. Scott grunted again. He wasn't a big fan of Maddie, and it was as much interest as he could muster in anything she might have had to say. At the reception, she told me that Neil was holding the electric fence. How the hell could he hold on to the electric fence, and why? I don't know. To make a fool out of her. She doesn't need any help there. But if it's true... Ah, Scott rolled over, facing away from her. I don't know what you see in that woman. Ellen rolled onto her back and listened to the quiet night. Just a sheep's bell jingling down in the pasture, and the waterfall whispering beyond. Do you think he knows? Scott took a breath. Doubtful, he said quietly. I know his mother wouldn't have told him. Ellen closed her eyes, listened to the waterfall. So many years. Let it go. Second of October. More than 12 years ago. Why keep the date? But you do. A Tuesday afternoon, Ellen's first year teaching, Neil's 12th birthday. Scott's older brother, Jonathan, convinced that his son's behavioral problems were the result of his unchallenged genius, had bought the boy a state-of-the-art computer for his birthday and stored it at Scott and Ellen's. Neil's mother, April, had arranged to pick it up the day of Neil's birthday while the boy was at school. Over the years, Ellen came to believe that intuition had brought her home that day. At the time, however, she thought she was just stopping in to check on her sheep. A hurricane had been moving up the coast all week and was due to hit Maine sometime in the evening, but it had reached Cape Cod hours ahead of schedule, and Ellen wanted to make sure the sheep were safe in the barn. The wind was already loud when she pulled into the dooryard. April's Jetta was parked beside Scott's Mercedes. Figuring he had come home for lunch, as he often did, Ellen stopped in the house before going to the barn to say hi and to see if April needed her to bring anything for the birthday party later. Despite the rain and wind outside, the farmhouse was strangely quiet when Ellen went inside. In the living room, she found wrapping paper spread on the floor, the carton containing the monitor sitting in the middle of it. Then she heard a noise upstairs. "Where are you guys?" she called and started up the stairs, unsuspecting. Then her bedroom door slammed shut. "Be right out," Scott yelled, but when Ellen went up the rest of the way and pushed open the door, she found the two of them standing on either side of the queen-sized bed, their backs to her. They were getting dressed. April turned first, with a kind of smile, more of a grimace, really. Ellen did not remember looking at Scott. What she did remember was the sound of his voice as she left the room and escaped down the stairs, through the house, and back onto the porch into the loud wind where the watering pails had overturned beside her black rubber boots and piles of brownish clouds tumbled angrily over the barn. Leaning on the porch rail, staring wildly off at her farm, the entire scene flattening before her eyes, Ellen finally heard Scott's words. "You didn't see anything," was what he had called to her. Then it was raining, and she was in her car, turning onto Main Street, a calendar image double-wide New England boulevard bordered by white colonial homes and wide sidewalks, crimson and yellow leaves ripping from ancient maples. Her new white pickup truck, her anniversary gift from Scott, sliced through it all, the rain, the plastered leaves, rippling this perfect place with confusion. The white-pillared town hall stood on one end of the town commons. A white-domed bandstand sat in the center. At the other end of the wet green stood the white Assembly of God church and parsonage, April and Jonathan's residence. The Reverend, no doubt closeted in his oakwood study, preparing Sunday's fire and brimstone sermon. Ellen pulled into the driveway without a thought about what she was going to say to Jonathan. She hadn't planned to come here. She had meant to return to school and try to finish out the day, but here she was at Jonathan's house. "Pastor Johnny," Scott called his brother, though never to his face. Jonathan was a charismatic faith healer who had recently earned his master's in theology from Harvard Divinity School. Brad Beecham, Destin's first selectman, claimed that Jonathan had cured his throat cancer with a touch of his hand. Marianne Clancy, a receptionist at the tax office, swore that Jonathan had driven the muscular dystrophy from her body. Similar testimony of his healing powers issued from scores of adults and children all over New England who had been cured of their ailments at Jonathan's hands. His church boasted nearly 500 members, 475 more than the congregation who had attended services until 1985, when he had taken over. Maybe it was because Ellen felt that she needed healing that day, the reason she went to Jonathan and not to her best friend, Maddie Sterling, who, after all, was a counselor, or to her mother, who would have only acted as if she'd seen it coming. When Jonathan let her in, Ellen asked if she could use his phone. "Is everything okay?" he asked as she dialed. In fact, she could not think of a single aspect of her life that was okay or would ever be okay. Everything was poisoned. She called the elementary school to have the bus drop Maureen off at Scott's parents' house up the hill from the farm. Then she called the high school. When Arlene Glanville, the secretary, answered, Ellen told her that something had come up and she wouldn't be back. Arlene told her not to worry, that school was letting out early because of the hurricane. Arlene asked if everything was all right. "Fine," Ellen said. "Because Scott just stopped by looking for you," Arlene told her. "Thank you," Ellen said, and hung up. All the while, Jonathan stood across the kitchen table from her, dressed in his white shirt and black necktie, watching with growing concern. "You seem troubled," he said. In years to come, Ellen would wonder if Scott's infidelity had been a brotherly thing. Jonathan, older than Scott by 6 years, academically superior, athletically superior, morally and spiritually superior, the favored son. Had this been Scott's way of evening the scales a bit? At the time, Ellen did not care about the brothers' rivalry. In fact, standing in the pastor's kitchen, she felt suddenly foolish that she had come here. Furthermore, she knew, with absolute certainty, that if there was any hope of salvaging their lives, that hope would be dashed if she told Jonathan. But here she was. "Did something happen to April?" he ventured. A short laugh escaped Ellen. April's betrayal did not surprise her. President of the Destin Historical Society, the Concerned Citizens Coalition, April with her colonial home and community standing, no, April did not surprise her. But Scott, who had always ridiculed his brother's high and mighty attitude, his sister-in-law's hypocrisy. "More honor among thieves than preachers," he'd say. "At least a thief only wants your money." Jonathan leaned his fingers on the table, his face clouding with concern. "Ellie, what is it?"
"Nothing. I just found them in bed together."
Disbelief. Jonathan, raising his long body, seeming to float on his feet.
"Scotty?" he answered.
Wind rattled the windows.
"Not Scotty and April?"
Ellen gave him another sort of laugh, as if this were Jonathan's own fault, or maybe she'd just thrown him an affliction that he couldn't heal. He pulled a chair back from the table as if to sit, then leaned heavily on its back.
"Are you sure?"
"I don't even know why I'm here," Ellen said, turning to leave, when the door blew open and April flew in, carrying a cardboard box that read "Monitor."
"She didn't see anything," April said to Jonathan.
Then she wheeled to Ellen, her lipstick smudged, her cheeks a deathly white. Jonathan left the room. April dropped the box on the counter and pursued him, saying,
"John, she didn't see anything."
As her voice trailed away, Ellen saw Neil's head pass the window. The door opened.
"All right,"
he said, seeing the monitor on the table. He must have read the turmoil in Ellen's face, because for the moment they just stared at one another while the trees roared outside and the rain beat at the windows. Neil was a bright boy, dark and quiet and exceptionally gifted, and Ellen wondered if he had any idea how his life was about to change.
"Maybe you should go outside and play for a while," she told him. "Yeah, in a hurricane," Neil said, and he turned toward the living room just as the footsteps drummed down the stairs, April's voice echoing through the parsonage. "John, would you wait?"
Jonathan burst into the kitchen with his trench coat flung over his arm, Neil tracking his father silently as Jonathan threw open the storm door and walked out into the wind.
"John, are you going to listen to me?" April cried.
Neil studied Ellen as his mother trailed off in pursuit, the sound of her voice chiming against the glass.
"It'll be okay," Ellen told him.
Then she left too. Out in the driveway, in the rain, she walked past April while Jonathan started his car.
"You didn't see a thing,"
April yelled at her. Ellen got in her truck and followed Jonathan out of the driveway, past the white church and down the road. When Jonathan turned right, Ellen went left, and she drove for the rest of the afternoon with no destination. The trees waving her wildly on, the rain and wind buffeting her pickup, the road signs shivering, windshield wipers dashing madly. Everywhere she went, houses were plastered with yellow leaves, roads littered with branches, limbs torn from trees. Sometime that night, in the full violence of the storm, she made her way to York, a neighboring coastal town, and knocked on Maddie's apartment door. Maddie was a counselor then with the Department of Social Services, and she had a small private practice in the basement of a pizza place.
She was in the process of divorcing her first husband, an anesthesiologist, while waiting for her next husband, a surgeon at the same hospital, to divorce his wife. When Maddie opened the door, she just stared at Ellen, an odd look of wonderment on her face.
"Everyone's looking for you," she said, trying to hand Ellen a cordless phone, as if they'd all met and sorted it out while Ellen had been out driving.
Ellen gave a sneering laugh, refusing the phone.
"Do you have something to put me to sleep? Valium, anything?"
"You don't know?"
"Know what?"
Maddie took a breath, kept her eyes on Ellen.
"Call Scotty."
Ellen heard the gravity in Maddie's voice, and her heart skipped.
"Jonathan," Maddie told her. "He hanged himself."
Ellen felt the building shake with a gust of wind, and she thought it was going to collapse around them.
Hanged himself.
She wanted to ask if Jonathan was dead, but she wasn't able to get the words out. Then she didn't need to.
"He did it in your barn," Maddie said.
She paused, staring soberly at Ellen, then added, "El, school let out early today." Ellen expelled a long breath of air, vaguely wondering what school letting out had to do with Jonathan's hanging himself. Then it hit her.
"Maureen?"
Maddie was already nodding. She took hold of Ellen's arms. "Mo found the body. She's okay."
"Oh, God, no."
Ellen leaned heavily against the door jamb. "Maureen's okay," Maddie said again. "The bus dropped her off at Scott's folks' house, but they weren't home, so she walked down the hill." Ellen turned.
"Have you seen her?"
"I've been waiting here for you, Ellie. What happened?"
"I've got to go,"
Ellen said, opening the door. Maddie captured her, held her arms. "El, talk to me." Ellen could feel herself trembling, spiked to the hilt with adrenaline, way too much to manage.
"I've got to see Maureen," she said, stiffening, wanting to pull away.
"She's at Jonathan's."
"At Jonathan's?"
The words didn't register. Jonathan was dead, hanged himself. Maddie nodded, kept their eyes connected.
"Everyone's at Jonathan's. April and Neil, Scotty and Mo. Scott's parents are there, too."
Again, Maddie tried to hand her the telephone.
"Scotty doesn't know where you are. He wants you to call him before you go over."
Ellen shook her head, desperately needing to see Maureen, but just as desperately wanting to avoid everyone else. She especially did not want to talk to Scott. Maddie's eyes darkened.
"If this is what I think it is," she said, pressing the phone in Ellen's hand, "you'd better get your stories straight before you go over there."
She seemed confident in what she was advising, so Ellen took the phone and dialed. Scott picked up after the first ring.
"Ellie?"
he said anxiously. She didn't respond.
"Everyone's here."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.